So Prime Focus, for those of you who don't know it, is now in its 19th year. It's maybe about 17 years as Prime Focus and 19 years from the time that we started. So we started in a garage, started with four guys. Today is 4,500 with multiple offices across the globe, more than 16 locations. And I'm proud to say a large part of that is very much India. So throughout the journey of Prime Focus, what we has obviously, you know, been quite satisfying is that India has played a huge part in all this. Prime Focus is a global company today. We would like to know ourselves as working in close partnership with the Hollywood studios, but we're very much an Indian company at heart. Our start has been with TV series, to advertising, to working with Channel V, MTV, working on a lot of AVs and documentaries, to working with the Indian films in visual effects for Indian films. That's been a large chunk of what work we've done for a long period of time, till a few years back when we started now trying to venture into the Hollywood space. And since then, we've worked on some of the bigger movies, including Avatar to Gravity, that just got acknowledged for its 3D that we had done for the movie. So I'll just show you a slight sample of the kind of VFX that we've been doing over a few years. That was a snippet of kind of work that we've done over a period of time. So, visual effects is magic. It's behind the scenes, it never comes out in front. Especially in some of the narrative-based movies, it's always something that has to be behind the scenes. It's not something that has to be in front. And that is always the challenge, because if you talk about VFX, then everybody knows how it's done. If we don't talk about it, no one really knows whether there was VFX or not. It
it's amazing the amount of time and effort that people put in to actually do that. I don't know how many of you are aware, but there are films that are made which require maybe about 1,000 people working across the globe.
Various facilities across 24 hours, different time zones, with a lot of technology that goes into it to just do one movie. Sometimes is good when people see it and marvel at it and really don't comment on it. That's the good part. When people start commenting on it is when we have a problem. But sometimes it's maybe just a 3-second shot and it's gone and no one really saw it. But it may take about 6 months with a few hundred people working on it to actually achieve that. With someone, with the supervisors at multiple levels actually watching it and commenting on it, it's nice, it's great, but that little edge over there, that little detail out there, what if we could change the whole thing? So in fact, I was just talking to someone from one of my international studios, and one of the things that they were just mentioning on a certain film, that after the film was delivered, after everything was done, the client came back and wanted to redesign something all over again. So this does happen. This is not, it's not about India, it's not about international. It's that level of detail and perfection that is required. And all that is only possible with a huge amount of passion that goes into it, where we have people doing that same job and making themselves better over maybe about 30, 40 years. So some of the supervisors that we have, some of the artists that we have been working at it for the last few years and moving from one level to the other. As technology develops, so does the visual effects. So what started off in the early days as just what was called special effects. So special effects was, and I'm sure a lot of you guys, when you all are talking also, you all mention it as special effects, not visual effects. Special effects was called special effects because it was something special done while they were shooting, which could be some just a painted backdrop in the background, or it is rear projection while someone is driving a car and you have just something moving in the back. Or in bigger movies, like the older movies where you had 10 Commandments or you had really big visual effects movies at that time, everything was done in camera. Everything was done by painting on glass. So if you wanted to show a castle in the air on a mountaintop, you had to actually paint that on glass and put it strategically, calculating the distance from the camera, calculating a lot of physics that went into it to just make it look like it's a castle in the air. We all saw it, we bought it, we loved it, but today when we see it, that's not it. Obviously, from that time to Gravity, where how do you make a film like Gravity? How do you make a film like Avatar? How do you make a film like, Total Recall, as what I'll show you next, is some things which are not possible. So way back in, I don't remember when, but when the first Total Recall came, I don't know how many of you guys saw it, it was an Arnold Schwarzenegger movie. It had some good visual effects. It had something nice, but how do you better it? How do you take it to the next level? What is it that will make it more the 21st century rather than, the 19th century? How do you take it ahead? How do you make use of technology? And there is so much technology that goes into the filmmaking today. So when we got into doing a part of Total Recall, where we were working with another studio, it was a challenging job for us. It was something that we had not done, that kind of work. And but let me show you something from there. part of the requirement of this movie originally was they were going to...
They've already shot the film. Oh, question, immediately. Well, great.
Actually, what I'm confused about is there are many scenes where, let's take the last scene, where Colin Farrell, he pushes the guy. So, what is shot in the studio, what is shot at the VFX?
Okay, let me go through a few of this, then I'll come back to that. Okay?
Thanks.
We got into this film a little late because some of these things were not a part of the original VFX requirement. It was an afterthought. It was one of those things because everything is on the computer. And everyone knows, at least the guys who make these films definitely know that it's not really a press of the button and it's done. But still, they would like to see, you know, a discussion happens and a few people get together and say, what if? What if we could actually do it? What if we could make these characters more robotic? What will make them more robotic? Right now, they look like guys with suits. And you're selling something which is in 2013 or 12 is when it released. And how do you make it believable, or how do you make it new? You don't want to show people who are just guys with, you know, wearing a suit and walking around. That's too old-fashioned. So they said, what if you could actually make these guys more like this? Where the first thing that you would do is actually show, how do you make a human look robotic? You need to take away parts of that. Once you sell this concept of seeing through the abdomen, once you start seeing through and start seeing more elements of the robot, okay, that's what's going to sell it. But we've already shot it, so how do we make it look? You're going to have it more like this. That's clearly not going to be possible by just having the guys who are there right now. So the requirement that comes in is just make it look like this. But you need to break it down. So the first few steps of actually creating this is all the principles of physics, all the principles of biology are all taken into account here to study the anatomy and make it into something like this, where you're actually building a skeleton, you're putting in elements over that, you're building the whole body. Once the skeleton is made, certain rules need to be set. For example, when you have something like a human body, your arm can only go this much. It cannot go beyond. So that part needs to be actually classified. It needs to be set up. And that step is called rigging, where you're actually making it bend, putting in hinges, putting in bones, putting in joints. It is that detailed, and it takes time. Sometimes just the rigging process may take maybe a month. After the rigging process, once you do that, you need to be able to test it, whether it really works. Part of the rigging has to be that when I move my hand, it has to move along with this. So if I'm doing this with one control, I should be able to move my whole hand. Now, in something like this, there is no real muscle, but sometimes there are joints that need to move along with it. So the effect of that needs to be done. So all this is intense, detailed work, which requires experience, it requires training, it requires a lot of technology, because without that, you can't manually do that. To top it all, once the character, once the model is ready, it needs to be textured, it needs to be define plastic, how shiny, how reflective, how does the light bounce off, how does the specular, how does the highlight on that, is it dull plastic, is it shiny plastic, is it reflective, glossy, like if you see the helmet here is completely glossy. So that's what needs to be brought out. Once those things are done, it needs to be put into this scene, which means we already have a character. How are we going to do this? We need to first remove some of that and then plug in our character over that and paint out some of the extra details that are visible through that. There is a character, as a character when it's moving around, every part of that needs to be match moved, is what that step is called, match move, to be able to track it onto that character and define it to get it that realistic, because that's what sells it. It's human-like behavior, but yet a little stiff. So it still needs to follow the rules of the human. And that step is called match move, where it's painstakingly each frame, it's frame by frame matched across all shots. So when you do something like this, where you're doing 200-300 shots, then all those 200-300 shots need to be matched. And then only does it move ahead. These kind of scenes, some of you might already know, it's a little easy to understand, and that's green screen. So in the background there's a green screen there that needs to be just removed. While we remove that, we need to put something back there. And there are huge cities that are built and that are put in the background over there. Something like that. That what you see in the background there is the city. So building that kind of a thing is called environments, where we are building complete worlds. We are building it not really to just replicate something, but a futuristic movie like this requires some concepts, requires some thought put into it, that how is it going to be? It's an artist's vision following the directive of the director of the art director of the movie. How is it going to be? What is this era? What kind of architecture does it have? What are the rules of that place? Does it have signboards, or does it have more New York type buildings? Does it have more stone structures? So it's futuristic, but yet has to be grounded in reality. So that is where concept art comes into play, where all those things need to be conceptualized and created. So some of these guys are all real. So there is, you know, in the background there are CG guys. That's your example of city. This is a combination of CG and there's your green screen. There are your CG characters, and that's the city in the background. So city, there are multiple ways of creating an environment. Sometimes it's complete CG, or sometimes it's what I started off by saying, that in the olden days where you used to have glass, painting on glass, an extension of that in the virtual world is called matte painting. Matte painting is an art. It's an extension of concept art, but it's a highly detailed art, working with textures, working with images, working with very high resolution photographs, where you're taking textures and actually painstakingly creating that whole world. You're painting in each detail. So that's because it's in the background, because it's not going to be upfront where a camera is going to move. Some parts of the process we use that in Photoshop. It's sometimes a few hundred layers that are put in Photoshop. I'm sure all of you all are familiar with Photoshop. And we create an environment. Sometimes it's the elements that are used in Photoshop are actually CG, computer generated images, buildings that are made a part of a library that you are creating for another scene, and you take it from there and you start using that. Each of the bullet hits, the glow from the torch, the light, all that is created in post. The bullet hits with the sparks are all created. And one of the easiest ways, of course, easiest things are the maps in the background. Those are taken as understood. Now, when a guy falls down like that, it's not necessary that there's always going to be this
perfect dust that every time comes up, which sometimes while you're watching a movie, you don't even think about. It just goes off. But actually, that's put in. That's generated dust to give that impact, to give that little, that smoke element over there, to give it that little mystery. All that is created. This is another example of a virtual world. This doesn't exist. How do you make a film where you're going to use so many different sets, such big environments? If you start creating it, it's just too expensive to actually create it. More than expensive, it's very difficult, because as soon as you make a big set, you need to put in that many lights. You need to put in that much time into actually lighting it. Every highlight, every detail needs to be perfected, because the camera is going to pick up. You don't know which side the camera is going to go. At the same time, it's going to have to pick up and be so detailed that the paint on that has to be perfect. The detailing of the molding has to be perfect. Now, this is all make-believe. You're going to shoot on this for maybe 2 days and you're going to destroy it. How do you create something so perfect that will last for a long time? That's where visual effects comes in, to help out, not as a cost saver. Visual effects is not just about cost saving. It's a more practical approach. It's a solution that is provided to the filmmaker, to the producer. Why would you want to go and make it when you can have the luxury of making it, changing it, building it in a way where it's not just done one day and you have to just take it? You can make some changes. Of course, you just need to control how many changes, because that's the scary part about visual effects, because you can do anything. You can keep making changes every day, but it takes time, and it's, again, that's where the cost factor starts coming into play. So this is a whole CG set that is built in. Sometimes a part of the set is built, and only where it goes out, that's where you start putting in. So something like this. So part of this is green screen, part of this is actually live. This is what I was talking about. This is a solution. It's not, let's just not shoot anything live, let's do everything in post. That's not a solution, that is getting away from it. That is just taking your problem and giving it to someone else. So, in this kind of a thing is where you build that original set, where you get that organic stuff, you get the camera actually capturing the light, capturing the way it's shining, the way it looks, and then we are adding to it, where we are adding and making it better, or we are adding and making it bigger. A set which costs maybe 100, suddenly if you wanted to make it the whole set and wherever the camera goes, that could land up being, you know, maybe 500. That's not worth it. So how do you control the cost? By spending 100 and spending maybe another few hundred in post, where you make it more cost effective. So this was a beautiful sequence. I really love this sequence, the concept behind it, the thought behind it. The content is what is the most important. The ideas have to be big. So now this is another complete CG environment with so many robotic characters. If you had to actually make all this live, in the older days, these would be like done by the set guys, by the model makers, and made put over there. But in today's virtual world, you don't really need to put it. That's more CG for you. So sometimes, again, you know, if you notice there is contact. That character actually has to be also put into CG. Though it's live, we have what is called a digi double of that, which needs to be created so it can be used, because the contact has to be perfect. So this is not a CG character, but parts of it are put in just so that there is contact. If you again, this is where the artist comes in, and this is the the pride and the pleasure, the passion with which, can you cut the lights? So with the passion with which these guys work, where there are so many small details in this, you can't see some of this in this dark, but there's so much detail that goes into this that that's what, it's the attention to detail that actually brings it out. So we worked on this across London with our supervisors in London. We worked on this in India. And it was a nice, it was a very satisfying project because it was something that we had not done earlier, not this type of work. And that's the fun of visual effects because you're doing something new every time. Something that really is, it's new for us, it's new for the artists, and it is the next step of filmmaking. So now there was that question. What was your question?
Hi, this is Tejas. What I was trying to understand was, in the scene, you got a live character, you got VFX. Now, of course, there'll be pre-production. I'd like to know how much of it is decided in pre-production, that what is the set, what is going to be the area that's going to be covered in the camera, what is going to be done in post, and how do we get the touch and the reality in the scene?
And now I give you all my secrets.
Yeah, if you can.
Yeah. Okay. VFX 1, 2, 3, and you're done. So to start with, pre-production is very necessary. The first step of actually getting into some of these bigger sequences would have been, we didn't do that part of it, but some of these sequences, you're right. How do you know? There are a few hundred people that are going to be involved with the film for the shoot, forgetting about the few hundred that will be working on the VFX afterwards. But the guys who are involved in the shoot, the DOP, the actor, the, you know, the even the guys, the assistants, everyone needs to know what it's going to be like. That's the first step of pre-production where you need to get into storyboarding. Before storyboarding also, what we always recommend is some inspirational art, which is the concept of that world, that environment. What is it? What is the, let's say, the 10 images that best explain this world? What are the 10 images that are in the director's head after going through the script and the inspiration which will drive everything downstream? So that's the concept art which takes prime importance, which you need to have, where sometimes it takes a few hundred images to actually discover what you're going to make. Based on that, storyboarding starts. While the storyboarding is happening, the next step is to take some of those storyboard images and to detail those out. Those become keyframes for driving the look of the film, which again, maybe a few keyframes as final images, but again, they can go through a few hundred iterations before. Sometimes the art department's rooms are filled up with just images stuck up all over the, and you can actually see the evolution of a frame from where it was to what it is, and it's like dramatically different sometimes because it's art. It can't just be there. You just can't give a directive and it's done. It's not. It's a creative process. It takes time. And so that's the first step. Based on that, we get into a previs. Previs is going into the virtual world, going into the computer world, and creating things in CG, which may be something like the grayscale images that you saw, but which are not obviously so detailed. Those are the rough ones. That's where the director is able to tell his story in a rough way. So some scenes, depending on the kind of movie, some of the movies have maybe almost the whole movie that requires a previs. Some of the movies have a slightly more evolved previs, which is something like what we're doing on the other project that we're working on, Sin City, right now. And that is, again, a virtual world. So it requires setting up that world in the computer space and showing the director, when your camera pans from here, which is just green screen, when you pan from left to right, actually, that's the wall you'll see. And when you see that wall, there's the pillar, and next to that, that's how we're going to make it. Camera angles are set at that time. And that's the basic way in which, that's the driving force for the rest of the team. So the concept art and the previs is what guides the shoot and what guides the post process also. So some of those decisions of how much of that set is going to be CG, all that is decided right up front. Sometimes there are changes. Like I said, it's a creative flow. Then comes the thought, what if? What if we, first we decide when you make the budget for the movie, it turns out that, okay, if all of those characters were CG, the budget would be X. So why don't we shoot with some? But after it's shot, as the creative juices start flowing, somewhere art starts overtaking a little bit, budgets start supporting the art, and you say, okay, let's spend X amount of money on trying to make it into CG. Or sometimes it's a way of convincing the filmmakers that, you know, it's just a better approach. So if you do that, then it starts looking. So that's a way of justifying it. But so yeah, so answering your question, that's where some of the decisions change. And that amount of liberty has to be there because, you know, there are films which are just locked down to maybe, you know, shooting it in a X number of days. And then there are some films which are, when you're shooting it live, they could actually land up shooting for 150 days, which is maybe excess for some, but that's filmmaking style for some. Any other questions? Let him get a chance. Okay, go ahead.
Again, taking the same shot. So, I mean, what I'd like to assume, I mean, rather understand is, so what's the scene where the guy is sitting in that, Colin Farrell is sitting and the guy catches him.
Yeah.
Is shot live and then replicated in the CG lab?
That's what I showed you first only, that there are characters which were shot. So that kind of a thing, even if it was planned as a CG character, it would still be shot with a person actually pulling him. And then it's painted out and replaced with a CG character.
Yeah, very good afternoon. This is Ajay from Bangalore. What I wanted to ask is, the moment in Indian film scenario, the VFX comes means it's only for big budget. Time and money, both will involve more. So is there any situation in Indian film scenario where people like your studio involved in small movies or independent film with shoestring budget?
What is a shoestring budget?
Oh, that's what I am asking. Many times we come across when a filmmaker with independent or done with shoestring, they come with since we wanted to make this with VFX, but we could not afford that budget, what studio asked.
Mm-hmm.
So we compromised. So we could, there it was, and we could not bring the creativity what we wanted to like that. Or is there, in future, if you want to put in positive way, is there any win and win situation for both?
So just, as much as I'm, that's what I started by saying, as much as I'm showing Hollywood work, the fact of the matter is that Prime Focus is very much part of the Indian film industry. So we are doing, Mukesh Bhatt's Aashiqui 2 also. At the same time, we are doing a Dabang also. So there are different ways of filmmaking. There are different, so Mr. Mukesh Bhatt is a very, very smart filmmaker. He makes it in a very tight budget, and those are successful films. At the same time, there's a Dabang, which is then larger than life and has Salman Khan and starts going higher and higher. So there are different ways of making films and different ways of doing visual effects. So can you do this the same way as you do an Aashiqui? No, you can't. But there is always a balance. Do you think they compromised or they didn't compromise? What do you think?
I think
in Total Recall, do you think they compromised?
There may be chances.
Chances is 100%. Filmmaking is a compromise. Sorry? It doesn't only depend on story. It's everything is budget driven. Do they have the same budget as an Avatar? Did the director see Avatar and say, okay, I'm also going to make an Avatar now, but it's my vision, I want to make it that way. Who's going to make it? At the same time, the revenue from this film and the revenue from Avatar, that's what drives it. So as much as I am from the creative side, I am at FICCI, and FICCI is all about the business of filmmaking. It's not just about the art. And it's a business at the end of the day. It's not just for the art. So there's a balance that we need to strike to make both the sides happen. So to answer your question a little directly, yes, we do to work with a lot of filmmakers, and that's why we want to find the most practical approach to making it. Sometimes you can't do something. Sometimes you want to do the same thing. It's a difference between having a camera that moves all over the place as opposed to a static camera. The content is king. If your content is good, you don't need to move the camera all over the place. It's when you want to confuse or you want to, you know, say something more is where you start moving the camera more. Because the difference between a static shot and a camera moving shot could be maybe about even as much as 50x. Because everything then starts becoming CG. It's like when I have a static camera, that could be just a matte painting. But I have a moving camera, everything becomes CG. And then what can take 5 days to do suddenly starts taking 50 days. So time is money. If I have 10 people working on a shot for the next 50 days, as compared to one person working for 10 days, that's your answer. You shoot a film for 1 day, or you shoot on a location for 2 days, or you shoot on a location for 25 days. Cost goes up. Can you still shoot it in 2 days? There's a little balance that you need to strike. That's all. Yes.
I had a question, and maybe it's not the right subject, class to take it because you're taking it on VFX masterclass. But I was wondering, you mentioned that you can do a lot with VFX, and it's magic, and it's a practical solution. And also you mentioned that Total Recall was an afterthought by the filmmakers.
Not the whole movie.
Not the whole.
Very so small part of it.
I was just wondering, yeah, in the future, is any of the movies actually going to be shot? Or is VFX really going to be...
Yeah, since then now you're getting into my second session. That's tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah. But to answer that, when you're making a virtual movie, like, you know, the very fact that just now what he asked about, was there really a character there? The character was there. And then it was removed to bring in that effect. So in Avatar or even in Gravity... Was there anything shot? It's shot, but it's of a different kind. You can't just start making the movie only in the computer. So there are some parts of the filmmaking process, they just go out of the real world and they just transform into the post world, into the CG world, which is not really post-production. So in the VFX world, yes, you still have to shoot. Was there any shoot in Avatar? Yes, you didn't go into the jungles and shoot. But you were shooting into in a green screen. The character movements, everything, are all done on the computer. No, they are still taking from live action. The character's lip sync, the movement, the face, everything is based on real characters. So that is called motion capture and it's called performance capture. So where you're actually grabbing everything from the live characters and applying that to the CG. So that's how you get the realistic movement. That's how you get the dynamics right. If you had to actually start from just doing it manually, it's not going to happen. So that's a different way of making films. But we are fast going into that space, and there are more and more films that are coming up with that kind of technology that is getting used.
In Gravity, while they are in space, the movement of the characters is in slow motion. So is that done by putting a wire or is it done in post? Or?
So the part of them floating is done by cables, but the actual dynamics of the hair, if there was, or of the cord that there is, some of that is obviously done in the computer, but otherwise it's shot at a higher speed. It's shot as slow motion. So some part of that comes in there, but the floating part of it actually comes through cables. That's what. So if there is dialogues, then those are all real. It's just the camera that is moving a little slower, or the whole puppeteering on the cables that actually.
Mix of environment, the lip sync was natural, but the volume was slow.
Exactly.
Possibly they could have been, the various environments being matched.
So just to clarify again, just so that to go on record, Prime Focus did not do the visual effects on gravity, we did the 3D conversion on gravity. But I can still give some background to that. There are different ways of achieving some of those things, in, especially in movies like Gravity, where there is so much, there are a lot of CG shots where you can't really make out that they are CG, but they are actually digi doubles, where the face is still real, but the rest of the body is not. But that said, something like that would still be done by just cables and slow movement of the camera, but everything else in the environment is all CG. So all your CG, so slow motion and your floating elements are coming from the CG part.
We have seen in the recent world that it's changing quite a lot, that from a natural, you normally, whatever movies now you're watching is like, all award-winning movies are like most of CG work and most of VFX work. So are we talking that the emotions are being overpowered with
the most of the things? Award-winning movies are not CG films. If you check back on the Oscars of the last few years, they're not all CG-heavy films. The movies that are big at the box office are 90% VFX films. That's the difference. But again, coming back to the main thing, what makes Gravity? It's not the VFX.
That's the storyline.
It's the story, it's the performance, it's the emotion. That's what makes it. And there's no shortcut to that. There is no replacement for that. That is the only thing. Content is king. That's first. Everything else is secondary.
Okay, so one more question on it. You have an office there in the rest part of the world apart from India.
Yes.
So whatever projects that you source from there, are we trying to say, it's not business question.
Yes.
So are we doing those projects here in India just to make more money out of it, or it is being handled there only?
No, we are doing a lot of the movies out here. We are doing, the way we function is we are a global pipeline, which means that at any given time on any given film, there are shots which are happening in India, happening in London, happening in Vancouver. So at times, it's just a better application of skill set, or it's a better division of work. The business of visual effects, in the recent past, we've already seen some of the bigger VFX studios. I don't know if you guys are aware, but a lot of the bigger VFX studios have had major financial issues. Because the films are growing so big, and at any given time, there could be about 800,000 people working on it, as soon as the project finishes, there's a sudden downtime. That means the costs are still running, but the next project will take a little time to ramp up. So those are the danger elements of the business, but that's where our kind of a model where we're trying to distribute the work across the global offices. Of course, there's a cost factor in it. But more than that, it's about sustaining a team, about keeping a team active. And in our case, where we are working on a Hollywood film or a Bollywood film, at any given time, there's work that is in the pipeline. And that's how we divide our work across.
How technically efficient should a director be?
It's a catch-22. How technically, if he is technically aware of everything, that's great. It's also scary because then starts telling you too much. But on the other side, it's always good to be aware of the visual effects, but then there are experts. It's like, how much does a director really know about the camera? But the DOP is there to give him his vision, but his knowledge of the camera is so critical so that he can add value to it, or he can let the other person do their job, but yet be aware of how it's done. So visual effects savvy directors are, sometimes it's good for them to be visual effects savvy because they can use it to their advantage more, because they are the ones who first start visualizing the film. And if you don't have complete awareness, then it's a part of filmmaking today. So it becomes very difficult for the director to think outside the box if he's constrained. It's like everything, if he starts seeing it as live action, then it's a problem. Like Mr. Sanjay Leela Bansali, whenever we worked with him in the past, he's such a visual director that right in the middle, you know, he spends so much time and effort in the design and the detailing of his sets. Now suddenly when he walks in on a set and he sees his beautiful set and on this side he sees green. And now that completely throws him off, because when he's thinking and he's visualizing, he wants to be free. But now he has to imagine something out there. That's where concept art helps, because you already have planned some of it in advance. But on the other side, you know, when working with him on some of his previous films, originally he started off with just one patch of green. By the end, by the other sets that he put up, by the last set, a whole side of the set disappeared, because he started taking it on as he was embracing it much more. So that was the advantage of working with him. So it is good to be VFX savvy.
So do you provide the inspirational pictures to the director, or he comes up with
them? It's a working with him. Filmmaking is a team effort. It's no one-man show. And at the same time, VFX is adding and taking the director's vision and trying to help him achieve that. So we are working with the director, we're working with the production to strike a balance between costs and creativity, and at the same time, helping them evolve that vision and put it down on paper. Because sometimes it's there in the head, but it's not crystallized. So the concept art helps crystallize that.
Are we saying we have a parallel team with the director and a producer to a yes. VFX director and a VFX producer?
So there is no such thing as a VFX director. VFX directors are VFX designers, but it's more the director's vision that the VFX supervisor works with for it to evolve.
It's being normally said that a lot of manpower is being used, hundreds of people have been used for creating so many seconds of this work.
Yes, yes.
And can you just tell a little bit, I mean, like, where does this manpower, I mean, how exactly for 2 seconds of time, 500 people are working 2 months in a day, and still you are getting 2 seconds of footage?
They're just damn slow. No, that's not such a direct thing. Of 500 people will not work on 2 seconds. It's not that bad also.
Yeah, but what yeah. exactly is the...
Yeah, so the... Like, I just explained so many things to you that when it's a virtual set, it needs to be designed. It needs to be... Maybe there'll be a different person who will just do the pencil sketching. After that, when it goes on to computer for the digital concept art, at that time it needs to be done in the computer. That's a Photoshop guy who will touch on it. Then there will be another person who will be just working on creating the model. Then there's another person who just works on the textures, another person who does the lighting, another person does the compositing. So these are departments. So it's a complete pipeline that happens. It's like an assembly line, and the shots go through that stage. And the more processes, the better it is. And that's how it's... Obviously, there are scenes that are being worked on. So sequences are worked on. So when there are sequences with 60 shots, then all 60 shots cannot be done by one person. So there is a team working on just the models, just the textures, just the lighting, and comp. So you can have maybe a 20, 30-member team that will work on a sequence of maybe about 30, 40 seconds. So it's not 2 seconds for 500 people. No, it's not that bad also. And we do hope it doesn't get that bad. Yeah. Yes, you have a question?
We've made movies like Ravan, we've made movies like Krish.
Ravan or Ravan?
Ravan, all right? Ravan.
Okay.
And we've made movies like Krish. Yeah. But India is yet to make a movie on par probably to Avatar or Gravity. Why is it so? I mean, you say we have studios that go there and do work there, and yet we aren't able to make movies of that standards.
Well, you know, for whatever it's worth, and that's, you know, something, some of it is, like this gentleman said, it's about making it in a practical budget, in a practical time, combination of all of those things. So the awareness of visual effects is just coming around. And it's good that there are movies like these which are now starting to come out, where people are actually diving into and taking up this challenge. But it's again, it's a time and money thing, that time and money is experience.
all put into one, if there is a practical approach to filmmaking, we can do that kind of work.
So you mean it's more lack of resources than lack of manpower?
It is a combination, I wouldn't say that. As much as, you know, we are as Prime Focus working in India, there are projects which are of a very high level where those expertise is now coming into India. The Indian visual effects industry has been evolving and it's getting better by leaps and bounds. So what we were doing a few years back on just working on Indian films, today Prime Focus is in a position to do the highest level of visual effects in India also. So that's an evolution and that will happen. The more films happen, the more awareness increases, the more awareness and acknowledgement that it takes time and effort. That's what, you know, even when I'm doing some of these sessions, that's what I try to do. I try to put, you know, as less people to sleep as possible, but there's one who's knocked off already. That's okay. That's fine. So, yeah, anyone else?
How much of storyboarding happens in India now?
How much do you want to do?
I think it makes a lot of sense to do it. I don't know. I mean, I don't know what is the level of...
There are people who do it. There are people who don't do it. It's again, everything comes down to finally cost. So it's an added service, added cost. Sometimes the director feels he doesn't need to do it because he has it all in his head. Sometimes they feel it takes too much effort to do it. But also it depends on the kind of movies you make. If you make a movie that demands it, then that's where you need to do. You don't need to do it for everything. For people who are used to make filmmaking, like there are directors who have got it so fast in their head, they just put the camera and they know what it is. And working very closely with the DOP, that partnership is so strong that between them, they know what has to be done. You don't need that. But there are some where there is an action sequence involved, where there are more people involved. It's a guideline for the rest of the crew, more than just for them. So that's where storyboarding starts making a bigger difference.
Ideally, it is meant for when you have to sell the entire story to the internal audiences or external audiences.
No.
Part of the team or
out? No. It's not really. So storyboard is not going to sell it. It's not going to be so helpful in explaining it to the rest of the world. It's more for certain sequences. Then there are movies that demand it because there's just so much going on that if it is not locked down, it's also a way of controlling costs because...
Yeah, so the producer has to be sold to the producer that these are the basic structures, these are the frames that we have to do, this is how it has to incur the cost. So probably that is one of the reasons for...
Sometimes. Yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
One last question can I ask. Correct me if I am wrong. Whatever the data I have gone through the study of making, Roland Emmerich's whatever Independence Day or 2012, which was more of effects, were done in a record span of time compared to all other movies. Is more people involved in that one at a simultaneous time or how it is done? If
I don't know where you read that. So I'm not sure whether that is, how true that is or no. I'm not commenting on that.
2012 was, what are the special effects were done in record span of 10 to 12 months.
10 to 12 months is not really a record, but I know what you're saying and it is possible. It is sometimes about being more clear, about being more organized, more planned, more previous. So we worked with that director on White House Down and we know the supervisors who were working on it from almost, I think, 3-4 months before the film. In fact, White House Down, you can say, might have been done in a more of a record-breaking time because they preponed the release by almost 4 months. So that's a shock that you get sometimes. But they were more, you know, very passionate about previs and storyboarding right from the start. So they were investing a lot of time and effort and we were sort of involved with that process earlier. But yes, so it's just, there's no shortcut to it. It's not just about lesser people is going to just be the thing or more people will just make it faster. It's about using a practical approach, a planned approach where it's a lot of technology that also starts helping out in this process.
Are you open to doing something in the area of education?
We haven't done education as in doing some kind of CG for education.
Like, I'm talking about, let's say, spiritual education, which requires a lot of abstraction and, you know, it's kind
of... We haven't done that. Actually, not correct. We have done some things for Akshardham and some things like that, but not specifically, not in a long time. But we are open to anything.
Because that would be not exactly the very commercial kind of thing, but in the educational space.
Sure. So, like I said, that you know, we've done, almost done it all for every level. You know, then the good part about it is in the early days, we used to have commercials happening or TV series happening. And every week we would have something to do with Prime Focus that would be on TV. And then there was a time where every week there was a release that was a Prime Focus release with either VFX or DI or something done by Prime Focus. And of late, we are, you know, happy to be in a position where there is a Hollywood film releasing, there is a Bollywood film releasing, there is a South Indian film releasing. And all those are Prime Focus films in some shape or form.
So
we have a like an Amazon model. You go on Amazon, you click, click, click. That's it. And pay for it at the end. We wish it would be that way, or you know, just keep swiping your credit card every time you want to do it, but it's not that way. It's a complex way of calculating. It's working with the realities of the filmmaker, at the same time, the reality of what we're trying to achieve. So I don't have a straight answer for you, because it doesn't work. It's the most complex type of service that is offered. In every other business, there is, you know, if you go to a restaurant, you have a menu card and you know what you are paying for. But you decide whether you want to go to a, you know, a five-star, you want to go to a regular restaurant, and you are expecting a certain cost. In visual effects, you want the five-star, but at that cost. So it's a very normal thing, it's standard. It's not about India, it's all over the world. We're trying to strike a little bit of balance in that, a little bit of education to the client that visual effects is not just about cheap filmmaking. It's parallel to that. So I don't have an easy answer for that. So there are different ways of calculating. Like I said, one of the ways of being practical and working out a solution is by not being crazy with the camera. So sometimes when you're static over a number of shots, then your cost gets amortized across the... We have sometimes requests for making a creature for just maybe 20 seconds of the shot. It's not worth it. It's not something that I'm making more money or lesser money. It's just not worth it. It's the wrong approach. Can you change your script a little bit to accommodate that? That's how you do it. Or you do a live shoot, or you take some stock shot and try to use it. So there are many ways of doing it. But if you say that, you know, like if you saw in the reel, in one of the Sajid Khan movies, there is a tiger with Ajay Devgan. Now, everyone would like a tiger like Life of Pi, you know. It's like your own pet tiger, do what you want with it. Unfortunately, that's not the case. So, that tiger was shot in Mauritius. The Ajay Devgan was shot in Hyderabad. And then we combined the two things. So, it's not easy. It's still difficult. It's still expensive. But that's a solution.
One final question, please.
Can we see Prime Focus getting into content generation anytime soon? And do we see that becoming a reality in India, like studios, like, you know, you have a Disney Pixar or you have DreamWorks. Do we see that happening in India, and will Prime Focus be the pioneer in that, maybe?
We are always open to that. We've dabbled with that, but we've not really gone out and doing that because the main part is whether Prime Focus does it or anyone does it. It's the content. If you have the content, then you create your own IP. If it is just for the business sake, and you know you're going to get caught at some point. So, content generation is a serious business. Has to be taken seriously. I hope you liked my session, and thank you.